Hi, everybody, and welcome to this episode of TensorFlow Meets. I'm Laurence Moroney, and I'm really delighted to have Ryan Sepassi from the Google AI research team. And Ryan, you work on TensorFlow datasets, right?
That's right.
So could you tell us a bit more about it?
Absolutely. So TensorFlow Datasets is a new library. It's on PyPI and GitHub. And what it aims to do is standardize the interface to a lot of public research data sets. And so we've actually shipped already with about 30 data sets, and we're adding more every day.
Nice. Now, one of the things that I found that, particularly when trying to learn TensorFlow, that a lot of the code that you see in tutorials is all about, here's where you go to get the data, and then you download it, and then you unzip it here, and then you put these files here, and then you get the features from here, and the labels from there, and that kind of stuff. Now, part of TFDS is really to try and simplify all of that, right?
That's absolutely right. We noticed the same thing. You know, researchers and folks who do machine learning, one of the first things they have to do is just clean the input data right off the bat. And input data is in all sorts of formats, which of course makes sense. You know, when you're generating data at rest to share it, it makes sense to have it in a certain format. But we, as machine learning practitioners, really want data in a format that's ready to feed into a machine learning pipeline. And so TFDS knows, you know, the format of all the source data sets, preprocesses them, puts them in a standard format. And now that standard format is ready to feed into your machine learning pipeline. So it should help both, you know, sort of advanced practitioners and people who are just trying to get started, because now it's the same API. It's like a one-liner to get, you know, a ton of data sets.
Right, and one of the really nice things about that that I found was that, like, for people who are just trying to get started, all of the tutorials all seem to have the same old data sets, right? It was like MNIST handwriting, it was fashion MNIST, because they were relatively easy to use, and they were relatively easy to get the data and to actually use it. Now we can actually have a little bit more variety.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, break out of the box of MNIST and fashion MNIST.
Not that there's anything wrong with them.
No, they're fantastic data sets. They've spurred the field on a lot. Data sets always do, but it's great to get, some variety. And especially for beginners, you know, you start out with these small data sets, but it's nice to be able to graduate to sort of larger problems, larger models. And now, at least for the data portion, you're not going to have to change very much.
Yeah, and a total shameless self-plug here, but I've been teaching a course on Coursera. And one of the things that was the feedback when we were designing this course was that, hey, we just don't want to do the same old data sets again. How do we get new data sets? And there was like so much work involved, and like maybe find a data set from Kaggle and then work on that. And it was like, no, let's see if we can build our own data set and contribute it back in. So we have a learning data set that somebody can use, we'll contribute it back in, and now the whole community can use that data set. And like the process behind that was pretty seamless and pretty painless.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Yeah, super glad that TensorFlow data sets could be helpful there.
Now, I can say I'm a little spoiled that I had somebody help me. There was a developer, actually, and Google helped me to get all the metadata that I needed to be able to publish my set into it. But how easy or how difficult it is if somebody wants to do it themselves?
Yeah, it should be really straightforward. We've tried to make it as easy as possible, and we actually have a really detailed guide that you can follow. And lots of people externally have actually now contributed data sets by following this guide. So if you go to the tensorflow.org/datasets site, we have a link to a guide to add a data set.
Okay.
And if you follow it step by step, it's pretty straightforward to get one in. The essential piece is to iterate through the source data.
Okay.
So whatever the format of the source data is, you know, it's NumPy arrays, it's in a binary format or in pickled format or whatever it is, you just iterate through it and yield records.
Okay.
And then document exactly what the features are. You know, I have a an image feature, I have a class label feature, it's got these classes, I've got a text feature, I want to use this vocabulary. And so those two things, just specifying the metadata and actually generating records out, are pretty much all you need to add this data set into TensorFlow datasets. The rest is handled by the library. And then once it's in there, you know, it's sort of, it's, you know, your data's famous. You can, you know, anybody who can pip install TensorFlow datasets can now load whatever dataset you just added.
Yep. I'm really excited to see how many people use my datasets.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. Horses or humans.
Horses or humans, and I did a rock, paper, scissors.
Awesome. Yeah, so everybody out there, make sure to use these datasets, binary classification tasks.
Yeah, exactly. And what was really interesting for these was that I wanted to experiment with, these are like image classification, but I created like photoreal CGI. And then to try and train a neural network using photoreal CGI and then see if it could classify real photos.
Ah, transfer over.
Yeah,
Yeah, fantastic. So, like, How'd it go?
It worked great.
Oh, amazing.
You know, so my horses and humans are all CGI, and then I like train a binary classifier with them, try to put in a picture of a real horse or a real human.
Oh, that's awesome. What did you use for the CGI? Like, how photorealistic was it, and how did you get them to be so photorealistic?
So there are some, basically, there are some rendering tools that you can get that are out there. Okay. There's a whole suite of different ones. I'm not going to promote any particular ones.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that kind of thing.
That's really
and
cool.
That you can use to just design CGI in that and actually render them. And it started as like a little science experiment.
Yeah.
And then it was like, wow, this actually works. But now TFDS, what that will do is actually allow me to share that with everybody else.
Fantastic.
Instead of like a random blog somewhere or maybe post them on Kaggle or something
right.
like that. It can
yeah,
actually
you
be published through TFDS.
Have a script, you know, that says, here's how you download the data, here's how you prepare it and all
yeah.
that. Yeah.
So I'm really excited to see like with this data, what people are going to do, and maybe they can train a far better classifier than
yeah.
I did. You know?
Awesome.
So,
yeah.
Now, so are there any other data sets that are in TFDS that particularly inspire you? Any that excite you that...
Yeah, so the ones that I'm actually most excited about right now are ones that we're kind of actively developing. So one of the things we're adding is support to generate data in parallel with Apache Beam. So this will allow us to ingest really large data sets. And so some of the data sets in the pipeline are like all of Wikipedia, you know, in every
wow.
language. Common Crawl, which is a public crawl of the web. And you know, these are really exciting data sets, but are not really possible to use without having parallel data generation. But we're working on that, and we'll have them really soon. And so those are the things I'm most excited about, because you know, enormous amounts of data combined with enormous models seem to be really promising direction. And I'm really looking forward to seeing the sorts of results that we get with giant models on giant data sets.
Yeah, so I mean, from the very basic entry level to have more data sets that people can learn from, all the way up to the like extreme research level.
Exactly.
To have like, you know, these kind of mega data sets that people can do. It's really interesting to see how much TFDS is going to kind of power research.
Yeah, I'm really excited to see that people, you know, we've gotten a lot of positive feedback, and that's felt great. And yeah, within research and yeah, all the way from advanced researchers to yep. you know, beginners just learning machine learning, seems to be a good utility library for lots of folks.
So anybody who wants to start using these or wants to start contributing to
yeah.
them, where should they go?
Absolutely. If you want to contribute, it's so easy to contribute, to get started contributing. You should show up on GitHub. We have GitHub issues for all the different data sets that have been requested. And you can just, you know, comment on it and we'll assign it to you, and you follow the guide and you can contribute a data set. And of course, if you just want to use it, then, you know, just pip install TensorFlow datasets, go to the TensorFlow website, find us on GitHub, yeah.
Beautiful.
Happy
cool.
data setting. Yeah.
Well, happy data setting. I like that. So Ryan, thanks so much.
Absolutely.
As always,
thank
this
you,
is
Laurence.
Inspiring, very informative, great stuff. And thanks everybody for watching this episode of TensorFlow Meets. If you have any questions for me or if you have any questions for Ryan, just please leave them in the comments below. And I'll put links to everything that we discussed in the description for this video. So thanks so much.